Good morning. Good to see all these smiling faces around here this morning on this beautiful, sunshiny first day of the week. I'm glad you came out to worship God. If you're visiting with us this morning, we are especially glad to have you here, and we treat you, all of our visitors, like your long-lost relative that we haven't seen in years. So if you're here with us this morning and visiting, we're so glad that you're here. Please stay around just a little while and let us tell you who we are and why we're glad to see you here at our services this morning. Next week, we're going to have a fellowship meal, so come back then and we'll not only greet you like a long-lost family member, but we will feed you as well. So again, it's good to see you all here this morning. A few announcements before we begin our service this morning. Let me see if I can get this come up. James Willis is requesting prayer, and Sister Kathy Bright sent me this just a while ago. And let me see if I can find it here. Here's what Sister Kathy reports, that James Willis has been to the hospital, but is home now. He was told it is possible that he has bladder or kidney cancer. James is requesting prayer. So let's remember James Willis in our prayer this week, as we do all of our sick, but especially Brother James. Today's a special day for the Shepherd family because the matriarch over there is having a birthday. Sister Betty's having a birthday today, so be sure and wish Sister Betty Shepherd a happy birthday. Brother Kyle Howerton requests that all the folks that have children, or if you're interested in the youth program, I suppose, meet down here in front with Brother Kyle right after service this morning. He wants to talk to you about some of the events that may be coming up probably for the young people. Got a couple of cards here that I want to read. The family of Baby Lux, Nash, Hobay, how you say that, Joe?
Holly.
Holly, sincerely appreciate all your prayers and help through this difficult time. Thank you. May God bless you all. And that's from the family of the baby, and it's doing much better. Has he got to go home yet, Joe?
Oh, yeah, about 3 weeks.
Be when?
About 3 weeks.
Okay, great. There you are. Okay. So that child doing much better than he was born. He was only a couple of pounds, so he's doing much better. Have another card. Your love and concerning spirit is clearly seen within your actions. Thank you so much and for your calls, notes, visits during the last 2 weeks. We are truly blessed with such a loving family. We love you all, Clayton and Kathy King. So I'll post these cards on the board in the back. Are there any other announcements that I need to make mention of? I'd like to read a scripture here to begin to set the tone for what we're here today to do, and that's to worship God. And I'll be reading from Psalm 63, 1 through 5. O God, you are my God, early will I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you in a dry and thirsty land when there is no water. So I have looked for you in the sanctuary to see your power and your glory. Because your loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise you. Thus I will bless you while I live. I will lift up my hands to your name. My soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise you with joyful lips. Your loving kindness is better than life. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, we're so thankful that you saved us from this world of sin and darkness, Father. Father, may we be lights in this community. To those that are round about us, Father, may your light be seen in us. And may your name be glorified in the earth while we live. Father, may we praise you and sing songs of your praise and think about you as we are on our beds at night and when we raise in the morning. May we call you blessed. May our lips always praise you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
First song this morning will be 15, Step by Step. Step by Step. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. I will seek you in the morning, and I will learn to walk in your ways. And step by step you'll lead me, and I will follow you all of my days. And I will follow you all of my days. And I will follow you all of my days. And step by step you'll lead me, and I will follow you all of my days. Next song will be 166. 166. He's my King. All day long of Jesus I am singing. He my song of joy will ever be. All the while he keeps my heart bells ringing, for his love is everything to me. He's my King, and oh, I dearly love him. He's my King, no other is above him. All day long in raptured praise I sing. He's my Savior, he's my King. Streams of love around my soul are flowing. From his heart flows everlasting spring. That is why my faith in him I'm showing. That is why an endless song I sing. He's my King, and oh, I dearly love him. He's my King, no other is above him. All day long in raptured praise I sing. He's my Savior, he's my King. In his light I'm going home to glory, with the soul through the saving grace, going home to sing and tell his story in the blessed sunshine of his face. He's my King, and oh, I dearly love him. He's my King, no other is above him. All day long in raptured praise I sing. He's my Savior, he's my King. 71, as the deer, 71. Following this song, Brother Jeff will guide our minds in prayer. As the deer pants for the water, so longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long worship you. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. I want you more than gold or silver. Only you can satisfy. You alone are the real joy giver and the apple of my eye. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
Would you pray with me, please? Our Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for this opportunity to come this morning and to meet His family and to sing songs of praise to you and to study from your word, Father, and to worship with our family, Father. We just pray that you will be with us as we do so. Help us to have our hearts and our minds in the right spot and area, and that we would do all things in a well-pleasing manner to you, Father. Father, we have many that are on our sick list and our list that are seeking prayers, and we know that you know their needs. We pray, Father, that you will be with each and every one of them and give them the help that they so desire, that maybe at some point in the future that they could return back and be back with us. Father, we know that this time and throughout the world is a time of where there's a lot of uneasiness. We just pray that, Father, that you will be not only with our leaders here in this great country that we live in, but we pray that you'll be with all the world leaders, and that they would seek the answers that would be peaceful, that they would seek the answers that would be pleasing to you, Father. We just pray that you will be with them and help them to realize what needs to be done. Father, we pray that you will be with those here, and not only in our country, but throughout the world, those that are help keeping the peace, helping those that are in need throughout the world, Father. We pray that you will be with their families as they are separated from them. Father, we pray that you will be with the police and the firemen and the first responders, and just be with them and give them the bravery that they need. Give them the peace of mind that to know that what they are doing is needed, Father. Again, Father, we're so grateful for this opportunity that we can be here this morning. We just pray that you will help us as we do leave here later today, and help us to remember that we are your children, we are the light of the world. We pray for those same things, Father, that you would give us that mindset that we need to share the gospel, that we need to take it throughout the world. Pray that you'll give us the bravery that we can do that. Father, we're so grateful for Jesus. We're so grateful for his willingness to give himself, to shed his blood, that we could have our sins forgiven. And we pray, Father, that you will forgive us of those sins. Father, we pray that you will help us to overcome those temptations in the future as Satan brings them our way. Again, Father, we're just so grateful for everything you do for us. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
A hill called Mount Calvary. This will be our song before we partake of the Lord's Supper this morning. There are things as we travel this earth's shifting sands that transcend all the reason of man. But the things that matter the most in this world, they can never be held in our hand. I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary. I'll believe whatever the cost. And when time has surrendered and earth is no more, I'll still cling to that old rugged cross. I believe that the Christ who was slain on the cross has the power to change lives today. For he changed me completely. A new life is mine. That is why by the cross I will stay. I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary. I'll believe whatever the cost. And when time has surrendered and earth is no more, I'll still cling to that old rugged cross. I believe that this life with its great mysteries surely someday will come to an end. But faith will conquer the darkness and death, and will lead me at last to my friend. I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary. I'll believe whatever the cost. And when time has surrendered and earth is no more, I'll still cling to that old rugged cross.
as it is each first day of the week, we present our worship to our Heavenly Father. And all of our worship is sacred and has been given to us by Him of what He finds acceptable. And Jesus Himself, on the night that He was betrayed, established this act of worship for us to carry out each and every first day of the week as well. In Matthew chapter 26 and verse 26 and following, in Mark chapter 14 and verse 22 and following, and in Luke chapter 22 and verse 14 and following, He established this memorial to gather around this table of remembrance that we call the Lord's Supper. He established these emblems for us to use to remember His body and His blood that He sacrificed on Calvary's cross for us for the remission of our sins. We have examples of this being done in Acts chapter 20 and verse 7 as Paul was traveling, and they did that on the first day of the week as he was on his journeys. We have in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 23 and following, the Corinthian brethren there were doing this each and every first day of the week. And in fact, they were misusing it, and Paul retaught them in that chapter 11 to conduct it as Christ had prescribed. So at this time, let us put the cares of the world aside. Let us clear our hearts and our minds as we remember the sacrifice made, as we have the blessing upon the bread at this time.
Please bow with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for the many blessings You've given us, the chance here to fellowship and learn more about Your word, Lord. And we pray that we take this time to remember what Your Son went through on the cross and remember what He did for the remission of our sins. And let us think about this and remember this as we take of the bread and the cup. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our dear Heavenly Father, we again come to you asking for your blessings on this fruit of the vine, which represents those Christians, the blood that your Son and our Savior shed on the cross for our sins. Help us, Father, to be mindful of the love and the sacrifice that Christ made for each one of us. Pray that we might take this way, be pleasing in your sight. In Christ's name, amen.
Was there anyone overlooked? Separate and apart from the bread and the fruit of the vine is also our instruction to give back as we've prospered. As we do this, let's have a prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the blessings of life, from your love to Christ's sacrifice on the cross, but also for our homes, our families, our jobs, and things of this life. And we pray as we lay by in store at this time that we do so with loving and cheerful hearts. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Song before our lesson this morning will be 431. 431. Break thou the bread of life. Break thou the bread of life, dear Lord, to me. As thou didst break the loaves beside the sea, be on the sacred page, I seek thee, Lord. My spirit pants for thee, O living Word. Bless thou the truth, dear Lord, to me, to me. As thou didst bless the bread by Galilee, then shall all bondage cease, all fetters fall, and I shall find my peace, my all in all. Please mark your books if you're using them at 917. 917. Let's
Jerry. Good morning. Glad to see everyone here this morning. It's always a pleasure for me to speak. Rick is, I guess, visiting his kids down in Arkansas, and I'm here to preach for you today. If you have a piece of paper, start writing the five top important things in your life. If you don't have a piece of paper, that's fine. Just do them in your head. And you can go from there. If you are writing them down, this might be some of the top priorities you have in your life. It may be your spouse, your job, your kids or family, watching sports or playing games, being on the computer, any of those technological things that you might do. Well, maybe in school activities, maybe ag, band, drama, any of those things that might be the top things in your life. Do you have those written down yet? Have you got those things in your head? As you look at those priorities that you have, is God on that list? Is God even make that list? If not, why not? In Matthew 6 and verse 33, we see, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. This is our passage for today. We will be looking at three R's here in this passage. But first, I want to find out what the context of what's going on in this is. It's on the Sermon on the Mount, for one thing. Matthew 5, 6, and 7, we'll look at 5 and 6, show us what is being said. The first thing being said, that we need to check our attitudes. The Beatitudes. Then we need to set the right example for the world, being the light of the world. Then we need to live righteously with a pure heart and loving each other. Then Matthew 6, we see we are to be seen by God and not man. And then we need to pray correctly. That's where the model prayer comes in. And forgive each other. And finally, seek heaven and not the earth, not the world. And that's where not worrying about the things of this world, but seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all those things I just mentioned will be added to you. The first R I mentioned a while ago is our responsibility to God. If you look at that, if we seek first the kingdom of God, what's our responsibility? Our main responsibility is to put God first and to seek those things. If you'll turn to Luke chapter 15, Luke 15, we see three parables in that chapter. The first one is the parable of the lost sheep, where we seek those who are lost, which is something that we really need to be doing to show our priorities. We need to seek the lost. Then the parable of the lost coin, where we are seeking in our lives what we can to do for God. In the parable of the prodigal son, where coming back to Lord. But we're going to look at that middle one. Just the first part of that. The last part is just talking about how when she found that coin, she rejoiced and asked others to rejoice with her. But I want to look at this first little bit of Luke chapter 15 and verse 8, where it says, "Or what woman having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it?" What this is reminding me of, and what I've read about, of course, on the right-hand side, you see that wedding ring. And on the left-hand side, in that day and age, that is the exact same thing as that wedding ring. When they got married, they got a necklace with coins on it. I remember one time, my mom lost one of her stones on her wedding ring. She had dad, me, my sister, all looking for that thing. Because why? It is precious to her. It was given by dad to her. And she was frantically looking for that diamond that came out of her ring. That's the same type of thing as that woman had. She lost one of those coins that her husband gave her. And she frantically looking for it. She looked until she found it. I don't remember if mom found that thing. And she's shaking, yes, she did. So that's good. But then she rejoices. Just like mom probably rejoiced too when she found that diamond. This lady rejoices. This is what we need to do when we are seeking the Lord. We need to find what we need to do. Another thing we need to do. How many of you have one of these? Probably everyone. How important is this to you guys? How important is that? Would you, if you lost it, look hard for it? Would you continue until you found it? I don't know of anyone that has lost their phone that would not look for that. One time I had some pants that had a shallow pocket in them. I went out to the grocery store to pay some bills. And when I came back, I got out of my car and my phone was not in my pocket. I went and put down all of those groceries, put them away, and then I started looking for that phone. Jennifer called it to see if I could hear it. We could not find it. Finally, I went out and it was laying on the ground outside my car where it fell out on the ground. But I frantically looked for my phone because it's something that I thought I needed. Would we do that for our Bibles? Would we do that if we misplaced our Bibles? You go, no, I know where my Bible is. It's sitting right here on the pew next to me, and it stays here. I always know where my Bible is. That may show where your priorities lie. It doesn't go with you. You don't study from it because it's sitting in the pew next to you. Is that how you are? Or this one? What if you forgot your phone on the way to church? You get half a mile away. Would you turn around and go get it? Or would that be something that you go, no, nah, we're okay. We're not going to need it today. We're just going to church. We'll be back. I bet most of us would turn around and go get it because it's something we think we need. How about our Bibles? If you're half a mile away, would you turn around and go get your Bible? Or would you say, no, the preacher will have the scriptures on the board? We can just look on that today. Where's our priorities? Where are they? Are they with the Lord? Or are they with man? This is something that we need to be very mindful of. Because we need to really think, where are my priorities? Our responsibility to God is to put Him first and to do His will. And this is something that we really need to do and think about. The second R we have there is to be right with God or right in God. If we look at that verse again, Matthew 6 and verse 33, it says, to seek first the kingdom of God, our responsibility, and to seek first the righteousness of God. Doing what God wants us to do. The right thing in God. The first thing we need to think of is, do I need to attend church? I understand sometimes we're sick. We don't want to spread any sickness to us. But if we just have something going on in our lives, is it something more important than God? Do we have something more suited than God for in us? In Hebrews 10, 24, 25, the Hebrew writer says, let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together, as it is the matter of some, but exhorting one another, as so much the more as you see that day approaching. Why is he telling us here? He's telling us, consider each other. Think about each other. Don't miss just because. Because if we are here together, we're building each other up. That's what exhorting means. We're building each other up. We're all for that. We're building each other up that way. Because it makes us feel good. We know what God wants from us in that way. We also need to help others. That's something that we need to do. That is right. In Galatians 6, verses 7 through 10, Paul writes, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. For if he sows to his faith or to his flesh, will the flesh reap corruption? But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. And let us not grow weary while doing good. For in due season, we also reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those that are the household of faith." What's our responsibilities? Our responsibility is to do good, to help each other out. If we see that in someone's life, we need to help them so that we can help, so we can do their will, the will of God. And if you do go and help someone out, don't stop them from doing it. In Galatians 6:2, we are told to bear one another's burdens as so fulfill the law of Christ. Sorry about that. We are to bear each other's burdens. Let's say we're going down a highway there, and we see Brother Larry cutting up a tree that had fallen over in his yard. And we have that, chainsaw with us, or even have a chainsaw at our house. And we want to go and help him. Not to put you on the spot, Brother Larry, but I think it's our responsibility not to go, no, I'm good, I can do this. Because I don't think you would do that. I think you would love to have anybody's help that would love to come and help a tree get out of your yard. But as Americans, we are very, very proud. We don't like getting help a lot of times. Because we want to do it ourselves. But it's our, don't stop someone from wanting to help you just because of your pride. Because that is a gift that we have to them. We need to give gifts to each other in that way. This is something that we need to think about in our lives. We have those responsibilities to God, and we have to do the right thing in God. And if we look at that verse again, Matthew 6 and verse 33, it says, again, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to us." So if we put God first in our lives, we continue in that. We have first, if we put God first and have his righteousness with us, We have a reward waiting for us of God. So you're thinking, we see that verse again. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. So if we put God first in our lives, we won't have to worry about our physical needs. No, we don't have to worry about them. Yes, we do have that. He will provide those physical needs. The reason I say that is if you'll turn to just up a few verses. In Matthew 6, 25 through 32, it says, therefore I say to you, do not worry about your life, or what you will eat, or what you will drink, nor about your body. What will you be put on? Is not life more than food, or body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. For neither they sow, nor reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? Which of you, by worrying, can add one cubit to his stature? So why do you worry about clothes? Consider the lily of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now if God has so clothed the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you? Or O ye of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall I eat? Or what shall I drink? Or what shall we wear? And then that next verse. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things will be added to us. If we seek first the kingdom of God, we should not have to worry about anything that goes on in this world that is a problem. This is something that we need to really think about in our lives. There's no reason to do this. There's no reason to worry about what's going on in our lives, because God will provide for us. That is our physical reward. But we also have a spiritual reward. If we put God first in our lives, if we put him where we need to be in our lives, put him first in our lives, we'll have that crown of life. In Revelation 2 and verse 10, we see this. To give a context of what's going on in this one, we have the seven churches of Asia getting talked to by Christ and to the angels of them. And Smyrna is the one he's talking to here. And he talks to Smyrna, telling them, there's nothing wrong that you're doing. Keep doing what you're doing. And then he gets to verse 10 where it says, do not fear any of those things which you're about to suffer. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison, that you may be tested. and you will have tribulations 10 days. So he's saying, don't worry about these things. If you put God first in your life, God will provide for you. And then he says, be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. If we put him first, and we do what he says, and if we put him first, we will do what he says. Why did he say he'll do? He says, I will give you that crown of life. Where are you in that relationship? Have you put God first in your life? Look at that piece of paper or in that mental picture that you had. Was God there? If he wasn't, why not? Why not? As we saw, we need to seek first the kingdom of God and God's righteousness. And we will be given, and all things will be given to us, physically and spiritually. If you are one that you have not put God first in your life, and you are a member of his family already, and you would like to get back on track and like to put him back first in your life, and you need the prayers of the saints, we ask that you will come and let us pray with you so that you can get back on track. Or are you one that's not even in his family yet? As we see here on this screen, you have heard what you need to do. And you need to believe what is being said there. And if you do that, if you have heard it and you believe it, you then need to repent of your sins. That means you need to do a total 180 and start going away from God, to God and away from sin. Then you need to confess that Jesus is the Son of God. And if you do that, be baptized for the remission of your sins. If this is the need you need so you can be put God first in your life, please do this. Let it be known as we stand and as we sing.
Savior, let me be thine heir.
Please be seated if you would, please. Closing song this morning will be 884. 884 before we go to God in prayer and with one of our elders. Earth holds no treasures but perish with using, however precious they be. Yet there's a country to which I am going. Heaven owes all to me. Out on the hills of that wonderful country, happy, contented, and free. Loved ones are waiting and watching my coming. Heaven owes all to me. Why should I long for the world with its sorrows, when in that home o'er the sea, millions are singing the wonderful story. Heaven owes all to Heaven holds all to me. Brighter its glory will be. Joy without measure will be my treasure. Heaven owes all to me. Heaven holds all to me. Brighter its glory
about you, but every once in a while I need a sermon like that to get my head back in line, right? How many times have I worried about the physical things in life? You know what? This life is temporary, but the life to come is one we need to be thinking about, putting our priorities right. Thank you, Jared. Now I gotta squirm for a little while, right? To help me get my life back in line. I'm thankful for that type of lesson. We have a great opportunity as members of the Lord's body to remember those who are not as fortunate as we. There are some of us that are sick, some of us who are facing some physical problems, some of us who are facing loss of loved ones, some looking forward, or maybe not looking so forward, to surgeries that are coming in the future. But the greatest things, you know, my 2 weeks that I've, since I've had my stroke, I could tell you were praying for me. You know what I'm talking about? You know it, don't you? You know it. So let's remember those that's in the bulletin. The list is long. It gets longer every day. Let's remember that list and pray for them. Just because they're not on the list doesn't mean we can't pray for them, right? You know, I'm glad to see Missy's feeling better, but she's still on my prayer list, even though she's not listed up here. Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm glad she's doing better. But you know what? Prayer helps. If we please, let's bow together.
We're thankful, Father, that you've given us this opportunity. This opportunity to approach your throne, to thank you for blessing us. We know, Father, there's so many times we take things for granted. We take our health, we take our physical things and that are just things. And we forget to thank you for the spiritual things, the blessings that you truly bless us with. We're so thankful that we have Jesus. Thankful we can approach his throne on behalf of those that are less fortunate than we are, those who are sick, those who are hurting. We pray, Father, that you'd be with each one of them. Help them, Father, through the difficult times in life. And now as we go through the remainder of this day, we pray, Father, that you'll dismiss us, but bring us back tonight at 6 so that we can be together again, so we can stir up each other in love and good works. And help us, Father, to always put you first. Help us get our priorities straight. In Jesus' name we pray.